The Lord be with you. We welcome you to worship on this day. We're glad to see you. It's a good thing to be together, to worship, and to wait upon the Lord. So why don't we begin, as we almost always do, by standing, welcoming those around us, and if you see someone you don't know, be sure to introduce yourselves.
Now to sign and pass the friendship pads that are on the ends of your pews. Just a couple of announcements. Immediately following worship, we invite you all to coffee and conversation in the gathering space, where if you ordered a Second Reformed Church
sportswear,
you can pick it up this morning. It will be on a table in the middle of the gathering space. So please go take a look at that. Some of you may not have paid yet, and this could also be an opportunity for you to pay. What am I doing wrong? I guess payment, I shouldn't mention that. Also, following that, there will be Sunday school for all ages, upstairs for the children, downstairs for junior and senior high and adults. And I hope as you came in this morning, you saw some of the coloring work that was in the cross, in the cloister walk, the stations of the cross. And so they will be up one poster a week for the next 6 weeks. So I invite you to take a look at those and use them during the season of Lent. Don't get too
close. Okay, hand me the paper. And into that. I don't know if that's got anything to do with it. But anyway, just a reminder, tonight, Faith and Film concludes. We're watching The Queen of Katwe at 5:30 in the gathering space, so come join us for that. And then looking ahead, we've got a good week of fun things. Thursday night is our final story slam of the winter, 7 p.m. out there in the gathering space. We've got storytellers from the congregation as well as the community speaking on home. And then on Friday, Davis has Second Fridays, 12:05. Enjoy an hour of organ music here. And also, just a reminder, then after tomorrow at about 7:15, if you are interested in making up the bags that we're collecting the food for, we'll be assembling those bags to be sent home with the young children over spring break. And then also, as you see, today we will have the joy of celebrating the Lord's Supper together. In your bulletin, there's a little purple box that gives you sort of the basic how-tos. Just a few little things. If gluten is a concern for you, you may go to the far station out here where the bread is gluten-free, although anybody and everyone is welcome there as well. If you'd prefer not to commune but simply to get blessed, come to where either Sophie and I are and cross your arms, and we're happy to bless you. And if you'd prefer to stay in your pews to receive, an elder will come to you. Just stay where you are and signal to them, and they will gladly bring it to you. And as always, though, our message about the Lord's Supper is that you are welcome and that Christ invites you to his feast. So know that you are welcome today.
Just a few things. We begin the season of Lent this Sunday, or actually the first Sunday in Lent, and as you'll see, there's a few changes in worship. We will sing the prayer of confession. We will say the Kyrie. Just don't worry about it, and it'll all come together. Just in terms of prayers and other concerns, the flowers up front this morning are from the visitation hours for Joan Farver that were held this week at Pellicorp. And then we'll pray for the Hirama family. Doug's brother, Bruce, passed away on Friday morning. His funeral will be at 2 p.m. on Wednesday at the Third Reformed Church. Are there any other joys or concerns or anything you'd like included in our prayers this morning? Yes. Okay, if you got your emails this week, there is still room in the group who want to go to Kansas City next weekend. So please see Andrea after church. Anything else? Let us worship God. Our help is in the name of the Lord, the creator of heaven and earth. In times of distress, call out to the Lord. When trouble comes like a torrent of water, it shall not reach you. You are my hiding place, O Lord. You rescue me in the day of trouble. You surround me with glad songs of salvation. I will guide you and teach you the ways you shall go. I will encourage you and watch over you with love. Do not be like an ornery beast that needs a bit and a bridle to stay on track. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, all you who trust him. Shout for joy, all you who seek the Lord.
Thank you.
trusting that God is merciful and gracious, let us turn to God in confession. Today we will sing our prayer of confession, so let us pray. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. And now receive this good news. They brought to Jesus a woman who had been caught in the very act of adultery, and they said to him, "Teacher, we have a law, and according to our law, this woman should die. What do you say?" Jesus bent down, and with his finger he drew in the sand. When he stood up, he said to them, "Let the one who is without sin throw the first stone." One by one, the crowd went away until Jesus was alone with the woman, and he said to her, "Does no one condemn you? Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." Beloved, hear this good news. Today, these are Jesus' words to you. "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. Believe it and be at peace." And then, as forgiven people, let us hear how God would have us live. Let mutual love continue. Hold tight to what is good and get away from what is evil. Be cheerfully hopeful, patient in suffering, persistent in prayer. Contribute to the needs of God's saints. Welcome strangers with hospitality. Rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. In as much as it depends upon you, live peaceably with all people. If your enemy is hungry, feed him. If your enemy is thirsty, give her something to drink. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Amen.
Jesus, save our need.
will you come forward? The Lord be with you. It's good to see you all today. Say, we've started a new season in the church. Can anybody tell me what that season is? Lent. And one of the ways, not Lent, Lent. Yeah, you didn't say Lent, you said Lent.
No, okay, but I always thought it was Lent.
Okay. One of the ways that we can tell it's Lent in the church is because the color on the tablecloth has changed to what color? Yeah, and right there. What color is it?
Purple.
Kind of like your dress, Natalie. Did you wear that for Lent?
Yes, I did.
You did. Good for you. Good for you. Your mom, too.
Yellow.
Yeah, you wore yellow. That's not a liturgical color. But that's okay. Hey, and did any of you notice when you came into church this morning through the cloister, was there anything new or different in there? Not you. I have to ask somebody else, okay? You always know the answers. Did anybody notice anything? Did you see anything? What?
I want to see worms.
Oh, you want to see worms, okay. But did anybody see anything on the walls?
No.
Anderson, did you come in that way? Yes, so you wouldn't have seen it.
Oh!
Yes.
The pictures.
The pictures, yes. There's pictures that people in the church have colored that we've put on the walls, and they're called the Stations of the Cross. And maybe you could go with your mom or dad or older brother or sister and go look at those and read what it says on the side, okay? It's some passages from the Bible, and the picture sort of tells you about that passage, so you can take a look at that, okay? But it's the story of the last few days of Jesus' life. So it's from the time Jesus was arrested until he rose again. And that's what we're going to look at. But because those posters are so big and it's too much for any of you to color, I have the smaller ones for you. So today, after church, do all of you know who Willa is?
Yeah.
Willa, can you raise your hand? Willa's going to have the coloring sheets for you, and after church, each of you can go get one, okay? And on the first page is all the devotions that you can do with your parents each time you color one of the stations, okay? And Willa colored the very first poster, so you can ask her about it, okay? All right. Well, I hope that you'll enjoy doing those with your family. Let's hold hands together and let's pray. Loving God, we thank you for today, and we thank you that it's the beginning of Lent. And we pray that during this season we might think more and more about Jesus and what he did for us. What he suffered, how he died, but also how you rose him from the dead. You raised him from the dead. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, friends, let's stand up and face the congregation. And let's receive our blessing. Congregation, will you bless your children?
You are God's beloved child. With you,
God is well pleased.
Thank you.
narrative lectionary from the Gospel of Luke. And today we come to Luke chapter 10, beginning at verse 25. So listen now for the word of God. A lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this, and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, the man asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him. And when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" He said, "The one who showed mercy on him." Jesus said, "Go and do likewise." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So your parents, do you ever look back now with grown-up eyes and appreciate situations they went through that you were entirely too young to even understand? Some of you, I think, were children during the Great Depression, and yet you probably had no understanding at the time the pressures your parents were going through trying to make sure that there was going to be enough food on the table that night. Or some of you, maybe a parent was deployed in the military for a long time or had to go away to work for weeks or months on end. Now you think about the stress that must have caused, but somehow as a child, you just rolled right through it. I have a friend whose mother suffered greatly from depression. But of course, no one ever said that when he was growing up. There were just days and weeks on end when Dad would say at breakfast, "Mom isn't coming out today." And everyone just assumed that that's the way the family was. When I was very young, my family lived on the far south side of Chicago. These were early suburbs built right after World War II for veterans coming home. Today, the homes would be smaller than most 3-car garages, but they seemed like nice homes back then. My dad was the pastor of a church that I would say was about half people of some sort of Dutch heritage and half community people. What I am most remembered for, although I don't have the memory of it, is that apparently when I was 3 or 4 and dinner was over, I would go camp by the front door, and I'd say to my dad, "No meeting, no meeting, no meeting." And my dad, to his shame face, I don't think he ever really got over it, he apologized to it many times, would step over me and go back to the church and say, "Just tonight, a meeting." And I guess I would burst into tears. Well, it was at one of those meetings, of course, I was completely unaware of it all, that something now, when I hear about it, rather dramatic happened. Now, remember, this is the early 1960s. It's the days of the March on Washington. Racial tensions were pretty high, especially on the south side of Chicago. Most of the people in that congregation had already moved once from the near south side to the far south side, part of what was white flight. As immigrants and, frankly, especially African Americans moved into the community, the white people moved farther out. And they were anxious in my neighborhood that the African Americans were coming soon. So that night at consistory, again, I'm unaware of all this. I'm just upset my dad's at a meeting. It came up that the very first black family had moved into our neighborhood. And my dad, during his pastor's report, said, "I intend this week to go and pay them a welcome visit." Immediately, I guess the room got a bit chilly and anxious. And one person said, "Well, Pastor, do you visit every single newcomer?" And my dad replied, "No, I don't know about them all. If I do, I'd like to stop in, but this is hardly just one more family. We all know that. Everyone's talking." A hand shot up, and one of the elders said, "I move that we forbid our pastor to go visit this family." Second. Now, the way my dad tells the story, at this point, his head is sort of spinning. This is the last reaction he had expected at all. He didn't know what to do or say, and he decided to just say nothing and let things unravel as they might. But he said in his head he knew that if it passed, the next thing would be the announcement of his resignation. And he said, "Instead of really listening to the discussion, I was thinking about how I was going to have to move us out, and maybe we'd have to go back and live with my parents for a while, and all these kind of questions." Fortunately, the motion failed. And that week, my dad paid a visit that he said actually was quite unremarkable on that first black family in our neighborhood. But it was a time, and again, as a 4 or 5-year-old, I was completely unaware of this, of great fear and division in our neighborhood, tension, anger. Frankly, it was just racism on some people's parts, just brewing all the time, and I was unaware. What I do remember, however, and this came back to me this week in ways I hadn't ever really expected, as I was reading and rereading the story of the Good Samaritan, was a sermon my dad preached. And now I think my dad was probably a pretty good preacher, although I really can't say I remember any of his sermons. But this week, somehow, I tapped into memories of a sermon that are over 50 years old, and I was surprised at how the little details all came back to me. That my dad told of a man who, in the afternoon, got off of the IC. I think that stood for Illinois Central. But we just called it the IC. And in the morning, all the men in their suits and their briefcases, I can still see the ramp going up to the station, and they'd get on the commuter rail and go into town. But this man in the story had gotten off of the IC and was in a hurry to get home, and so he went down an alley. Now, you don't have to be a creative genius to guess where this is all going, but he was jumped and beaten in the alley, and there he lay, bloodied and unconscious, wondering what was going to happen next. I remember at that point myself being a little bit anxious and scared. I rode my bike up and down the alleys all the time. Was this something dangerous I should be worried about? What happens next, I'm not entirely sure of, but I think the story went like this, that a Catholic priest was coming down that alley a few minutes later. There were a lot of Catholics in our suburb, and the Catholic priest saw the man lying there and thought, I have a meeting I need to get to, and I can't stop. I'll be late for my meeting. Somebody else will certainly see him and pick him up. And the next one was a minister, because here I can remember actually visually seeing my dad in my imagination walking down that alley as I saw it. But he looked at that bloody man and thought, oh, that's going to be a mess. I'm going to get all dirty. It's going to be complicated. I don't want to get involved. And he, too, walked on. Well, then comes the part, and by now I think you probably can all guess it. An African-American man, or as my dad would have said in 1964, a Negro came down the alley. And there the beaten man could see him and thought, oh no, he is here probably to finish me off. But instead, the black man knelt down and cared for him and picked him up and brought him to a place where he could be cared for. Well, I know that 50 years later, that story sounds cliche, almost quaint, but even as a 5-year-old in church, I think now that somehow I could sense the tension that was in the sanctuary that day. And we could all together sort of feel the audacity of Jesus' story all over again. On the south side of Chicago, in a white church, those were scandalizing words. Just as they were scandalizing words 2,000 years ago when Jesus first told the story of the Good Samaritan. This week, just in talking to several of you, I heard several different versions of the Good Samaritan happening in your own life. One person told of a family of sort of white bread, straight-laced people on vacation in the 70s when their car broke down and they were camping. And who was camping next to them but sort of a bunch of long-haired hippies with Volkswagen, a van. And of course, you know how it works out. The hippies were generous and said, here, use our car, take our food, what do you need? And the suspicions and wariness of the family were worn down by the hippies' generosity. Or some of you may have heard recently of an artist. He has some connection to our congregation. Look for his book in the church library. His name is Joel Schoontanis. He's the son of Elliot and Elaine Tanis, and there's going to be a few of you that nod and say, I know who that is. Joel recently painted a picture inspired by Van Gogh's Good Samaritan. But Joel's is called not the Good Samaritan, but the Good Syrian. And in the painting, there is an Arab-looking man helping another man onto a donkey to safety, and the man who has been beaten has a Confederate flag tattooed on his arm. What's almost more interesting is Joel is selling prints of the Good Syrian, and Sophie and I tried to order one when all of a sudden we got this odd email telling us that Homeland Security had shut down sales of this painting, and then it became okay. But just the words, the Good Syrian, was enough to sort of throw the internet into a tizzy for a bit. Sophie loves to tell the tale of a couple years ago when her father was visiting her mother in a rehab facility, and through all sorts of misunderstandings, he missed the last bus home. And what is an 80-year-old man supposed to do when he's 8 to 10 miles from home and the buses have stopped running? So he begins walking. And after about a mile or so, and I don't know how to nicely describe Sophie's father. Get back to me on that one. But a young Arab stopped and opened the door and says, "Where do you need to get, old man?" and took Sophie's father home. You probably have similar tales, too, of receiving help from the people you least expect it, people you despise, people that scandalize you. We hear these stories every once in a while. The stranger who gives a kidney to someone they've never met, the passerby who runs into a house on fire and rescues someone. Generosity, kindness from the most unlikely of sources. So as we hear this story, I come away with three questions for us. First, who is your Samaritan? Who are those people or that person that you can hardly imagine doing good to you? These are people that if you really you think about it, at least right now, you think, I think I'd rather lie there bloodied and beaten than be helped by that kind of person. People that disgust you, that you disagree with, that you despise. Who are they to you? And to think right now that the grace of God is always bigger than our little minds and our categories. Second, what is it that keeps us on the other side of the road, away from where the bloodied and needy people are? You know, the Jericho Road in Jesus' day was not a six-lane highway. It was maybe a glorified cart path. So to go around this beaten and bloodied man, literally you would almost have to step over him. Might that suggest that we really don't need to look that hard to find those people who might not be bloodied, might not be laying on the side of the road, but still are very near to us, and we step over them all the time? Why is that? What would you say right now? I'm too busy. It's messy. I don't want to get involved. It might be dangerous. I have no expertise. All true enough. All very true. But I'd ask you now to just actually spend about 10 seconds in silent prayer talking with God about what it is that keeps you on the other side of the road. Just say it to God, and maybe not now, maybe now, God will help you think about how it is we can stop stepping over these people and instead stop and help them. And finally, who needs you to be a good Samaritan this week? Who is beaten and bleeding and ignored and stepped over by all sorts of everyone else? Who is your neighbor? In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Beloved in the Lord, having heard God's word, we are now invited to respond. And one way we do that is to stand and say what we believe today using the words of the Apostles' Creed found in our bulletins. Let us stand and say what we believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Let us lift up our hearts and minds to God in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, overflowing with love, filled with steadfastness, care for us. We pause for a few moments now to look back with gratitude on those people who have stopped and rescued us and cared for us, hugged us, given us an encouraging word. Those who planted faith in us, those who have watered that faith, for all those people that you have sent our way, that have been blessings, that have been life givers, that have been servants of you, we are thankful. Even as we ask that day to day, sometimes heroically and more often in quiet and small ways, we may be good Samaritans. That we may care for the broken, we may encourage the downtrodden, we may love the unlovable. By your Holy Spirit, enable us to be more courageous than we are. By your Holy Spirit, open our eyes that we might see those who are in need. Far, far away, in countries that we hardly can find on maps, and down the street, and at work, and in our own families. Give us courage. Give us safety, that we might reach out in love in Christ's name. You know our lives. Indeed, they are filled and harried. And yet, if we have to say out loud or to our neighbor those things that weigh on us, they seem so small that they are almost embarrassing. That situation at work that doesn't go away. That decision about finances, we wonder what to do. A relationship with a brother or a parent or a child that we wish were a little smoother and easier, and we hope one day we'll be reconciled. That grief, that broken heart that just continues to hurt. Thank you that we can say all of these things to you. Thank you that in your own mysterious and wonderful loving way, you are moving all things toward wholeness and reconciliation through Jesus Christ. We remember today those who are hospitalized, those who are alone, those who are seeking meaning, those who are awaiting an invitation, those who wonder what it means to follow Christ. Send people, send us to be bearers of good news. We remember those who grieve. Bind up broken hearts. We pray especially for the Harima family and for the Farver family in these days. And even as we weep with those who weep, we also rejoice with the Browns and the Barnes as they welcome Noah. Bless that family. Bless Noah in ways that we cannot know, that already he may sense your love, in his life. And now, in a few moments of silence, hear those prayers we hold deep in our hearts. For your love that always welcomes us, that's always seeking us. For your ear and your heart that are always open, eager for us to turn to you and pray to you. For your watchfulness and care that never ends. For the hope of eternal life, for resurrection through Jesus Christ. For all of these amazing, incomprehensible gifts, we give you thanks and praise. And now together we offer the prayer that Jesus taught us together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Jesus says, to whom much is given, much is asked. Let us bring our offerings to the Lord.
Thank you.
give you thanks, O God, for all that you have given to us. And we thank you for the privilege of becoming givers ourselves. And so in these gifts, we seek to honor and worship and serve you through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Jesus says, "Look, I am standing at the door and I knock. And if anyone opens the door, I will come in and eat with them and they with me." So right now, Jesus is knocking at the door of your heart, asking you to open the door, not so he may come in, but rather that you may come and eat at his life-giving table with him. And so again and indeed, we invite any and all of you who seek to share in Christ's feast to come to this table.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
Right it is and good to give God thanks and praise.
Gratitude, praise, hearts lifted high, voices full and joyful, these you deserve. Everlasting and ever-loving God. You freed the slaves from Egypt, leading them through the waters to freedom, feeding them with heavenly bread. Then, when the time was right, you sent Jesus Christ, your eternal Son and our Lord, who took upon himself human flesh and the burden of our sin. He was despised and rejected by many, a man of suffering, acquainted with weakness. He was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Yet you raised Jesus from the dead, opening to us the gates of heaven. For this and all your abundant blessings, we raise our voices, joining the choirs of heaven and the faithful of every age to sing. Most righteous God, we remember in this supper the perfect sacrifice offered by our Lord Jesus Christ once upon the cross for the sin of the whole world.
Your death, Lord Jesus, we remember. Your resurrection, we celebrate. Your coming in glory, we await.
By your Holy Spirit, may we be living sacrifices burning for your glory. In the bread we break and the cup we bless, may our hearts be fed by the communion of the body and blood of Christ.
Come, Holy Spirit, make us one with Christ and unite us with all who share this feast.
As this grain has been gathered from many fields into one loaf, and these grapes from many hills into one cup, grant, O Lord, that your church may soon be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom.
Until then, nourish us, that we may be faithful in serving you, befriending the outsider, sharing with the poor, reconciling with our enemies, and loving our neighbors. Even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And after he had given thanks and blessed it, he broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
And after they had eaten, Jesus took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant poured out in my blood for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, for all things are now ready.
Beloved, Christ has fed us at his life-giving table. So with heartfelt thanksgiving, let us join in praise.
Gathered in God's house and sung God's praise, heard God's word, and been fed at God's table. So now, may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Go in peace. Amen.